tutorial on getting around in a database. If you just really love the sound of my voice and you want to listen to it, there's a video of this presentation that Ms. Westcott is taking for her sixth hour. You could listen to that if you really wanted. I'm assuming you don't. So we are all going to click on collection of research resources. So English 12 research, collection of research resources. The very first thing. And then the first thing in there is a Google Doc, research essay template. I'm going to have you open that. Even though you aren't writing an essay, you are still going to have to gather information, and you do have to have a work cited, and this does a lot of that work for you. So log into your @apps account. And once you have this file open, you're going to go down and make a copy. So make a copy of this file. You're going to replace where it says copy me, copy, 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 with your last name. And this is hour 5. Make sure you save it in a place you'll be able to find it again. So the name of the file should be your last name, hour 5, research 12. I want you to get in the habit of putting files that you're going to share with someone else, making sure your name and what the file is a part of the file name. Because if you go to college, you're probably going to have to email things to professors. If you are applying for jobs, I know, for instance, the federal government, if you apply for any of their jobs, you have to submit everything as a PDF. I was just helping my mom apply for a job at the VA hospital, and she had to submit a whole bunch of things as PDFs. So when somebody is A, going to be grading you, or B, possibly giving you a job, you want to make their life easier. You can make their life easier by putting your name and what's in there in the file name so that they don't have to open it to see what's in there. Because you can use this exact same template for all of your research papers or all of your English papers for the rest of the year, we're going to set this up as if you were writing a paper. First thing, double click where it says last name. And then type your last name.
So if you're not doing this, you should be doing this right now. We're not taking time just to sit and do nothing.
Name. And where it says last name, put your last name. So now I should just say your name. Instructor's name, Acosta.
Your due date, Ms. Gahasa?
Just put the day, I don't know, just put today's date for right now.
Okay.
Six.
you won't need all of this information. If you were writing an essay in this document, you would put that here. You would delete all this and put your essay there. It does have some helpful tips in there for what you're doing, like center your title, do not bold or underline. But right now we're gonna go scroll down to the bottom. And you're looking for your works cited. This is set up in MLA already for you with the hanging indent. I know it's kind of a pain to do a hanging indent, and you actually cannot make a hanging indent on your iPad. So this way, this is already done for you. And this will make your life easier for your paper next term, if you're able to do it this way. So you will delete these and put in your own works cited entries. I did put in some templates, so if you, for instance, have a magazine at home that you want to cite, this is how you would cite it. And so you can use that as kind of a fill-in-the-blank template if you like. For most of your citations, I'm hoping that you're going to be using the databases, and they will do the citations for you. If you're using a website, you can use EasyBib, but I've heard some rumors that EasyBib will not be free for much longer. So I'm looking around for other possibilities. We're going to leave this window open, leave this tab open, and go back to our collection. The Purdue Online Writing Lab, OWL, has everything you could possibly need to know about writing research papers. It's super helpful. And it also explains MLA citation really clearly. So that's something you might want to reference, especially if you're not super comfortable with doing research. This next thing you don't need to open right now, but I'm going to show it to you. This you only need when you are at home. When you are at Park, all of the passwords are kind of built in through using our IP address. But when you're at home, you aren't on that IP address. And so you'll need to use passwords to get into our different databases. You can open this document if you are signed in to your apps.district833.org account. You cannot access it if you aren't logged in. It has to be password protected legally. So Ms. Acosta has said, do not email her in the middle of the night asking about database passwords. You've got the information here, and I've also got it in a bunch of different places on the library website. Next, we are all going, here's a link to EasyBib if you need it. How many of you have done research with Wikipedia?
Never.
I have.
I've always been told I'm not allowed to.
Well, here's the thing. Wikipedia is amazing. It can do so many things, and often it's more accurate than other sources because it is so up to date. People who are experts in the field update constantly. Actually, if you go to Wikipedia during a presidential election and you go to a candidate's page, you'll see that it's changing hundreds of times a second because there are people updating it constantly. There are also people vandalizing it constantly, and then there are people cleaning up the vandalism constantly. So a lot of things are super accurate, and that's awesome. But it does have some limitations. So when something happens, can I get a light, please? When you're researching something, there are a few different types of resources. So you have the thing. Anything that directly reports on that thing, so like newspaper articles, videos of the thing, audio of the thing, people tweeting from the thing, those are all primary sources about the thing. Anyone who's reporting on it who wasn't there, that's a secondary source. People who look at the primary stuff and say, this is what that means, and comment on it. Wikipedia uses those secondary sources to comment on the thing. So if you look, we are 1, 2, 3 steps removed from the thing, whatever it is that you're studying. If you use Wikipedia as a source, you are now 4 steps removed from whatever the thing is. That's not good. to giving the specific information you need. Wikipedia is great for building your background knowledge. I use it all the time. There is no shame in using Wikipedia. You cannot use it in your paper. You can't copy and paste parts of Wikipedia, even if you use quotation marks inside it. You can't use it. You also can't paste chunks of Wikipedia in your paper and hope that Ms. Acosta won't notice, because she's a smart lady and she will notice. So, the thing that is also handy when you're doing research, if you look up your topic and you're reading about it, facts in Wikipedia are required to have citations, just like you have to cite things in your paper. So if you click on the little number at the end of a sentence, it will take you down to the citation. So you can go to the source that that person used for the Wikipedia page. If you use that source, so if we go to this nuclear energy page, I could use that document. I can't use Wikipedia, but I can use sources that Wikipedia also used. Back in our collection, we're going to click on the EBSCO databases. Databases create like a home base for a ton of information. So databases will search magazines, newspapers, peer-reviewed journals, video, all that kind of stuff from around the world from thousands of different sources. So you don't have to say, look up the New York Times, and then look up the Wall Street Journal, and then look up Time Magazine. You can look at them all at once. It will look it up for you. We're going to start with this points of view. So it's got the two faces looking at each other.
I mean, they could be a face.
Mm-hmm. And I'm going to show you an example of what a lot of people try to start with when they're searching for a topic. So I'm going to say, is nuclear power good or bad? So that's called a natural language search. But I've got a problem here. So I was looking up, is nuclear power good or bad? The decline of newspapers is bad for the U.S. Polygamy is bad for families. Outsourcing is bad business practice. Is any of this to do with nuclear power?
No.
No. So you can't use natural language the way you might use in Google to search a database. You want to get down to just the most essential words. So you don't need any adjectives like good or bad. You don't need any conjunctions like or. You don't need a verb like is. So now I've got nuclear power. So you want just the main words. One or two words, usually nouns, that are the core of your topic. The reason I like this database so much is because it will give you an overview. So maybe you aren't an expert in your topic. Open up that overview, and it will tell you all about your topic. It will give you the background you need to know. And this can be one of your sources for this first section on your wiki. So if I'm going to use this, I'm going to do something first. First, I'm going to click on cite. This is all different styles of citations. So I'm going to scroll down to MLA, that's the style we use. I'm going to copy this. When you have a keyboard, you can use Control C in order to copy things. So I copied it. Now I'm going to go over to my Works Cited, hit Enter, and Control V paste things. Uh-oh. Ms. Acosta, does that look okay for my final paper?
Can't even see it.
So that's not going to work. My favorite command of all time on the computer is Control Z, like zebra. That is undo. If you hold down the shift bar and then do your Control V to paste, it will match the formatting that's already there. So that will make your life just a little bit easier if your work cited is already ready to go. So I'm doing that before I read the article, before I mark the article, before I print the article. The reason it's so important that you do your works cited first is because if you don't, you're going to have trouble doing the citation later. I taught English at Park for 12 years before this year, and every time we did a research project, I would have at least one child come up to me and say, "Can you help me cite this?" And I would say, "Where did you find it?" And they would say, "I don't know." And I would say, "Well, who wrote it?" "I don't know." "How did you find it?" "I'm not sure." "Well, I can't help you. And I want to hit you, just a little." So, I didn't hit anybody, I just wanted to. So, do this first before you do anything else, and it will make everybody happier later, and you won't make Miss Acosta want to hit you.
I would scream, I would hit you.
What? So I've got this article. I would suggest, if you aren't planning on printing things, that you do this next part on your iPad. The copying and pasting of the citation is easier on the computer, but this next part you're going to want to do on your iPad. You're going to print. And when you click print, that creates a PDF. This PDF you can send straight to Notability, and now you can write on it. So that's how you'll get your stuff, so you can save it. There was another thing I wanted to say about this.
Points of view.
Checking my notes. So points of view can be really handy, especially if you have a topic that people argue about. I'm going to go back to that EBSCO, that main EBSCO database. I'm going to click on the first one, EBSCO Research Databases. And it gives me this whole list of databases I could pick. You don't want to select them all because it slows everything way, way down. I'm going to pick the Master File Premier and the Mass Ultra School Edition. They'll cover most of your needs. If you are doing something that has to do with a medical field, or something to do with science, I would choose one of those databases. So I'm going to choose these two and then continue. And I'm going to put in my search term up here. So I searched for nuclear power and I got 44,000 results. That is too many. There's no way I can work with that much information at once. So I need to narrow that down. The first thing I'm going to do, and most of our databases have this information on the left. Actually, what I'm going to have you all do is stand up, please. Pause. Stand up. Stand up. Take a deep breath and then like lean over and kind of let your body hang like this. Do it.
Why, everyone?
If you can touch your toes, do that, but really I just want you to hang your body like this.
This is as far as I can go.
I mean, I can touch my feet, but not this. I can't touch my feet at all.
And then sit.
I can put my hands forward.
So if you follow directions, you just did two things. One, you got your blood flowing into somewhere other than your rear end. And two, you relaxed yourself. When we sit at a computer especially, we have a tendency to kind of hunch up and tense our muscles. And when our muscles are tense, it tells our body that there's an emergency. And so then we're under stress and it's harder to work. But when you hang like that and kind of relax a little bit, it helps. It tells your body there's no emergency. So it's a good thing to do if you are stressed about something or if you've been sitting for a long time. So I have all these results. There's no way I can look at all this stuff. I don't even know where to start. First, I'm going to limit to full text. Okay, I don't want summaries or like partial articles. I need the whole article. So first, I'm going to limit to full text. Next, I need current information. I do not need nuclear power information from 1900. So I'm going to pull this publication date over to 2000. 18 years is plenty of history. And you need to hit enter to make it update from there. Maybe. I could limit to academic journals. Academic journals means people who are experts in the field, professors, doctors, that kind of thing, are writing the articles. If it's peer reviewed, it means that other experts in the field looked at the article and said it was okay before it was printed. Something else you may want to do is make sure you're only getting English, if that is the language that you speak and work in. So I'm going to say peer reviewed. What happened to my first search result here? So just like I couldn't use that natural language, that whole sentence, to do a search, there are certain phrases and words that databases prefer. And the way to figure out what the database wants you to say, because it's picky about language, so it's able to give me articles that have nuclear power in the title. But I'm going to scroll down here and click on subject. And then I'm going to show more. This is also a way that you can use to find something more specific within your topic. So I want nuclear energy. That's what I'm interested in. That's what I want to study right now. Update. So the language the database wanted was nuclear energy. And now I know that I can use that search term and it will work better for me. Okay, now I'm down to 183. I could shorten up this publication date a little bit more. I might go to just magazines. Maybe. Okay. This is easy to start with. And this one totally has nothing really to do with my topic, so I'm not gonna read that one. I'll read this one. Again, I'm going to get my citation before I do anything else. Scroll down, get the MLA citation, copy it. My notability and mark and find what I need to find. So that, I want everybody to start with an EBSCO database. Even if you think your topic won't be in there, just give it a try. Because the thing that the database does is it finds reliable information for you. You don't need to worry about who the writer is, who the publisher is, all that kind of stuff, because you know it's good information. I'm going to show you one more thing on here. Well, a couple more things. One, if you are searching Google, I would suggest that you look at these Google Scholar search tips. They will help you be a better searcher. Also, if you find yourself stuck, you're working on your paper, it's late at night, you have a question, you know you can't call Ms. Acosta. I will not be answering my phone, but you can call a librarian. So this is a link to ask a licensed librarian a question. They'll help you out. I think that's amazing. Next, I'm going to the Gale Virtual Reference Library, GVRL. And there's actually going to be two GVRL links in here. One is the books that we own, and the second is some books that we have as a trial right now. So additional information that we have. So these are all books that PARC owns the ebook. We might have the physical book, but we also have the ebook. And the cool thing about this is you can search inside the books like you do in a database, and you don't have to like find a physical book, look through the book, find the table of contents, find where your information might be. You can just put in your topic gives you, these are all from books. And this is helpful. Sometimes you have a requirement that you have to use a source from a book. I know that Mr. Blazier does that for his drug project. So if you need a book, this does it for you. I only want English. This is kind of nice because it also offers you the opportunity to choose the content level of the stuff you're going to read. If you know you struggle with reading, you can set that to basic, and then you'll get things that you can read. Because if you can't read it, it doesn't matter if you have all the information in the world.
Ms. Warner, you said that this also tells you what page the information is
on.
You
don't even need to know what the page is because when you click on this, it takes you to the page.
Whoa, okay.
So this is the page from the book. I don't need to look it up or find it. It's right here. And if I were using this, I would go citation tools, copy and paste that MLA citation, make sure it says MLA here. Paste that into my Works Cited. And then I could say download PDF to send that to Notability so that I can mark the text. This one also has those subject headings that we talked about earlier. These ones are not alphabetical, I do not know why. So I'm looking for, these are also related topics, nuclear energy. So you might find something that's related to your topic that you're interested in. Subject, location. So here's the last thing I'm going to show you from this. This is the topic finder. If you have a general topic, let's say you want to write about cars. If you do a search on cars, you are going to get a bazillion T results, and it's going to be hard to figure it out. A good rule of thumb is, if you could get a book that is just about that topic, the topic is too big. You need to be more specific. So you need to choose something within that. And if you do that here, I'm still searching nuclear. I've still got English, those things. I chose the basic level of reading. And now it's going to show me, Now it's going to show me different topics within the topic of nuclear. So I'm interested in, and these ones are little, potential means, science. So I'm interested in energy sources. So I click on that. And then it gives me some subtopics. So I want to know more about nuclear energy and power plants. And now I've got 5 articles that are about exactly what I want to learn about. How many sources do they need, Ms. Acosta?
I'll tell them in a second, but we're going to need 5.
5! So could I be, like, done?
No.
If these were all 5 good resources that I could use?
Oh, all 5 good resources?
Yeah.
Potentially. Mm-hmm. Potentially, yes.
So if I find the info I need here, my work is done in terms of finding things. So this is a super cool, I needed this when I was a freshman in college and I said I was going to write a paper about Sephardic art and I took home 20 books from the library and left them in a pile on my dorm room floor and opened them the night before the paper was due and it just like more specific. So that will help you narrow down, or it might help you see other areas that you can look into to do your wiki. I think that is all I have for you today.